Good morning. Welcome to our Rodeo Roundup Sunday
at New Hope Church. Great to have you with us today. This is normally the service where it's kind of packed, you know, all the seats are full. But after the end of the next service is when everybody gets to eat. So some of your regular 9:15 crowd are coming at 10:45, all right, and they're just going to go from here to there, all right? Here's the secret. If you guys get back about 5 to 12, you'll be in line first. Yeah, I have a wife telling me you need to end on time today, all right? So anyway, it's Roundup Sunday. Thanks for being here. We're glad you're a part of our worship service this morning. If you are a guest, it's your first time with us, we're honored by your presence. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. We'd love for you to take one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We make a promise we're not going to beat on your door, not going to bother you on the phone, but through the mail, we're going to send you some information that tells you about what we believe and what we do around here and the ministries that go on, and hopefully answer most of your questions. And if you have more questions than what that answers, then please feel free to call us or fill out another card and say, bother me. And we'll be happy then to reach out and to do our best to answer more of your questions. But it's a joy to have you here. Let me take care of one little bit of property business real quick. Some of you may have seen signs out by the drinking fountains or in the bathrooms. It says, don't drink the water. We are a public water service because we are on a well here. And that well is monitored every month, all right? So it's tested, and it's been going on now for about 14 years. We've been doing that, and we've been good all the way along. Recently, we had a test where a small amount of coliform was detected in the well. Now, any of you who live in the country, you probably have it in yours, okay? Good chance. It's not E. coli, all right? It's not E. coli. They tend to come for two reasons. If you've had a clean well and you end up with that test, for one of two reasons. Number one, you've tested right after a heavy rain. Guess when our test took place? Right after that 1 inch of rain, all right, 2 weeks ago on a Friday night, and the test was done the following Monday. And the reason is because the water percolates through the ground, which is where out here, this used to be a horse ranch. And I'm probably going to tell you more than you want to know about this. Because kind of where it comes from is from feces, all right? So if you got little bits of that, you know, in the ground, the water percolates through, and it's on the surface then of the aquifer, and it hasn't had time to be, you know, kind of gone through the rock and the sand and the gravel yet and get all cleaned up, and it will in a while, then it will show up. Or if your well has been open for some reason and people have done some work on it. Well, the county made us put meters on our wells here, even though they can't supposedly charge us for our water. I expect a bill down the road from them since they're on a meter now. And they wanted to know depths and other things, so they've been open. So all this took place right after that. I don't believe there's a danger in washing your hands. I really don't think there's, quite frankly, a danger at all, but we have to follow the guidelines. And the guidelines are we cannot use it until we pass another test, all right? It has been treated, it has been dealt with, and another test will be the first of the week. But in the meantime, that's why the special water things are in each of the buildings. That's why the coffee setup's a little bit different, because it's all bottled water now. And so everything's good for today, and it'll be good for the next Sunday and the Sunday after that. But when those signs come down, you'll know that we've had a clean, wow, we had a dirty test. Just thought of how that sounds, all right? Yeah. But anyway, that we had a dirty test, yeah. We're on probation now. But anyway, that's what the status of that is. So forgive me for taking time, but wanted to explain that. Next of all, we don't often do things like I'm about to do, but we're going to make an exception today. Next Sunday, there is a very important private event taking place here. But it's when I say private, it's we didn't plan this, but we're happy to be part of it. Earl and Emma Rowland, all right, members of our church, are celebrating their 60 years of marriage next Sunday afternoon. That's pretty big. And they're going to do that in two ways. Number one, at 1:30, right here, next Sunday, 1:30 in the afternoon, they're going to renew their vows. Earl said he's enlisting for another 60 years, all right? Because Emma told him to. And so a brief service, 1:30 to 2, if even that long, right here. And then afterwards, they are providing a reception, a cupcake and beverage reception afterwards, all right? They've been doing this with word of mouth, all right? And that is tough for them to really know how to plan when you do something word of mouth. So I said, okay, let me address this Sunday. And some of you may have known about it because you were part of the word of mouth invitation. Some of you, this is the first time you've heard about it. You are welcome to attend both the ceremony and the service. If you think that you're going to be attending that next week, all right, we would love it if maybe you just take a card or an envelope that's in the pew in front of you and say 60th anniversary, yes, and how many's going to be there, or call the office by Tuesday or Wednesday of this week, or send us an email, all right, and just let us know. And that way we can know how many to anticipate and be ready and set up for, okay? So that's next Sunday afternoon. Today, time schedule in here for roundup activities out here. There's going to be tri-tips. There's going to be hot dog, tri-tip sandwiches, hot dogs, chili, chips, beverages. It's supposed to get to 90 degrees today, so Kona ice is going to come. If you get lit up by the chili, you can cool it off with a good snow cone afterwards, all right? They're going to be here from 1 to 2:30, and a great way just to sit out and enjoy an afternoon and maybe meet people you've never met before. And you are going to be waited on by all of your elders and staff of the church, all right, this afternoon. So thank you so much for helping in that area. We've set a date for our next baptism. It is May the 22nd. If you have accepted Christ in your life and not been baptized and would like to be, take a card, put your name on it, indicate baptism, and we will follow up with you, get information in your hand about that special day, and we will get it organized. There are 30 women from New Hope who are up in the mountains today. They are at a women's retreat. Ah, there they are! There they are! They are at Calvin Crest. Look how nice and polite they're sitting. All right, that is wonderful. And so, they're having a grand time. I've had two or three texts back and forth that they are doing great, and they get back this afternoon sometime. Okay, so be praying for the rest of their day together. The Secret Church simulcast, we've talked about that in the past. Please see Mark Addis if you're going to be attending that special event. It's 6 hours of in-depth Bible study, and it will be good. It always is. May the 1st is going to be Mexico Mission Night around here. That's a Sunday evening. It's going to go from 5:30 to 7. Our junior high and high school kids that went to Mexico during Easter week are going to regale you with music, and they are going to show you slides of their trip and the projects that they did and the baptisms that took place in the ocean, and they're going to give testimonies. So all of you who help support that mission project, want to see what's going on, come back that night from 5:30 to 6. They're going to have a taco truck right out there. All right. Don't drink the water. I mean, yes, drink. Yeah. Taco truck out there. It's great. It's going to be good food to kind of get you primed and ready for their mission trip. Now let me move to some prayer requests. And we've got quite a few today. We're going to take a few minutes to do this. Arlene Bropes was an 8 o'clock service. As you know, she's going through cancer treatment right now. And she was feeling stronger today, and she's out. Polly Good is not able to be with us today, but I've chatted with Polly a couple of times this week, and she's getting stronger, and this coming Tuesday, she will go to the doctor and find out what the next step, the next kind of treatment that will be necessary for her to go through. Peggy Dunlap's mom back east is not doing well. There's some health challenges there, and Peggy will be heading back there sometime next month. So please be praying for them as they go through these challenging times. Joni Jarbo, who's normally sitting right back there on the back row, she is in Oregon with her daughter, Mariah. Remember, Mariah is her daughter who was diagnosed with cancer during her pregnancy with her first baby. Had to wait till the baby was delivered to start treatment. And now that treatment has started, baby's 3 months old, now that treatment has started, she cannot have contact with her baby for 3 months. Okay, so challenging time. That's why Joni is up there as grandma and caregiver. And so just be praying for them. All is going well at the moment, according to Joni. Helen Heath, Helen and Richard, who normally are sitting right in here. Helen is in the hospital again at Kaiser. But this time they have finally found out what is causing the problem that's put her in the hospital 3 times in the last couple of months. And that is an ulcer, and they are treating it, and she should go home either today or tomorrow. So continue to be praying for them. Mary Kay Beard. Does that name ring a bell to any of you? Mary Kay Beard. Okay, she has some people nodding their heads up here. Mary Kay Beard has spoken in our church about 3 times over the last 15 or 16 years. Mary Kay Beard was formerly an an inmate, all right, in one of, what state was she in? Yeah, she was in a federal institution. Was it Georgia or Alabama? I think it was Alabama. And she actually was supposed to never get out. She was, get this, she was a bank robber. The little bitty short lady, all right? This was Bonnie, all right, from Bonnie and Clyde. Actually, it was a Bonnie and Clyde story. In prison, she found Jesus, and man, was her life transformed. And through some pretty miraculous events, as we've heard her story here, she was eventually released. She went to work with Chuck Colson, and they launched nationwide, worldwide, Angel Tree. That was her brainchild when she was in prison. And those of you who are here remember her telling that story. We just got news this week that she is now under hospice care in her home state. So if you would be praying for Mary Kay and their family, I know they would appreciate that. Rich Smith, our counseling pastor here at New Hope, his mom, Marna, who was a regular member of our church for many, many years. Shelley and I saw her Sunday afternoon. She was under hospice care. She was bright-eyed and talkative, and we had a great visit with her Sunday afternoon. And Monday afternoon, she was smiling in Jesus' face. And so her service is going to be on Friday the 22nd. Be right here at New Hope this coming Friday at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And so you were invited to be a participant in that memorial service. Don Nicholson is a longtime Clovis resident, served on the Clovis Rodeo Board for many, many years. His daughter was Andy Nicholson. Andy, 14 or 15 years ago, was the Clovis Rodeo Queen. And I was with their family Wednesday morning at about 9:40 when Don took his last breath here in the ICU ward where he had been at St. Agnes Hospital for 47 days. And had an opportunity to pray with him before all that took place. And that service is going to be held here on the 20th at 11:30. So if you know the Nicholson family, please be in prayer for them. What a great, wonderful family. We've had a great visit this week, but just be praying for them. Jim Harris, how many of you remember Jim Co. in Fresno? You remember Jim Co.? All right, you had to be here for a while. Jim Harris was the first manager of Jim Co. in Fresno. And when Jim Co. closed down, he then became the manager of the first Costco in Fresno. And his son, Jim Harris, is currently the manager of one of the Costcos in Fresno. But Jim Harris had been under hospice for about 4 months, and he went home to be with the Lord just about 8 days ago. And that service is going to be here at the church on the 23rd of this week at 10 o'clock in the morning. And then many of you have been praying for my aunt. You knew her because she was in our church for 7 or 8 years. She was our secretary here for about 7 of those years. Her name was Billy Adams. Many of us called her Toot. That was her nickname. It was Aunt Toot. And at 3:40 yesterday afternoon, with 6 of us gathered around her bed, Aunt Toot went home to be with the Lord. She had been under hospice care since Tuesday, and very rapid changes with her, but very peacefully, she went home to be in the presence of the Lord. And her service is going to be here at New Hope on the 29th. So Friday the 29th, we're uncertain of the time yet, but we'll keep you posted for those of you who knew Billy. Boy. Quite a list this week, huh? Jan Patton, continue to pray for her and her recovery at Fresno Community Hospital. Saw her on Friday. Friday afternoon, they were hoping to take out the intubation. Was that done? Does anybody know? Did that happen on the weekend? They were open. It's 3 steps forward, 2 steps back in her recovery. So continue to pray for Jan as she goes through this process. So those were the updates that we wanted to bring. I'm sure there's more, but we're going to stop right there. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the life that we share with you. We thank you for your strength, for your peace, for your joy, for your contentment you give to us in some of the most challenging circumstances of life. Father, there are times that that we feel like we have been drugged through the ringer, and yet you tell us that your grace is sufficient for us. And so, Father, I trust that we will experience that kind of grace in our lives today. You know why each of us are here. You know what intent and purpose that you would like to accomplish in each of our lives. And I trust that we will give you freedom to accomplish those purposes in us. We love you. We want you to be magnified in the way in which we sing, with an attitude of trust in you, the way in which we pray, with a surrender of our needs to you, and with an attitude of obedience, that as we hear your word challenge us, that we will put our trust in you and demonstrate that trust by obeying your leadership in our life. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks for trusting you with the needs of care and comfort in so many families who've been challenged with death in the last several days. Thank you for your all-sufficiency, which is enough in all of these circumstances. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. That's exactly what Psalm 27 is all about today. How do we overcome? It's because he did. So I invite you, if you want to find Psalm 37, we're continuing our series in the book of Psalms this morning. Not going to do any review. We might do a little bit more of that again next week, but we're going to jump right in with Psalm 37. When Billy, Aunt Toot, it was a week ago that she went into the hospital, and after some tests, they realized that there was nothing more that a hospital could do, and they sent her back to the Carrington House, where she had been living for just about a year. She loved it there, and man, did everybody love her. I can't tell you all the other women and some men who stopped by to check on Aunt Tooth this past week, and how they said, man, she brought life to this place. And we're going to miss her. And I went down on Monday because there were some other decisions that they were trying to make. And we asked for hospice to come in so that they could have more care besides just what the staff at Carrington House could provide for Billy. And they were absolutely wonderful, just as Heinz Hospice here in our area is. They were there. And Tuesday afternoon, it was determined that really Billy shouldn't be up walking around anymore. The Alzheimer's would prompt her to go for late night walks and attempt to leave the place, so they had to put a monitor on so that we would know. Oh, by the way, how do you like those saddles up there, huh? Al Gould tooled both of those saddles. The one on your left, I don't know if you can see, but it's got an Indian peace pipe, all right, engraved into it, and the owner picks that up tomorrow. And the one on the left, Al Gould did, and it's owned by a gentleman in our church, all right, the head of our parking posse outside. And you're looking at about $60,000 to $70,000 worth of saddles right there. There is a guard that you cannot see, and his weapon is trained, all right, on that stage. But anyway, we're so grateful for the use of those today. And then you see the picture and the posters up, and those are done by our own local artist, Claudia Fletcher, all right? And she's going to be with us in our next service, but she's been doing the rodeo posters for years and years. So just to add a little rodeo flavor for us, they've helped us out this week. Aunt Toot on that Tuesday night was found in her closet, taking her clean clothes and putting them in the dirty clothes bag. And they found her also on the floor. Thought she was fine, but 2 days later, as swelling and bruising appeared, it was revealed that she had broken her hip and dislocated her shoulder. Things began to deteriorate very quickly. I'm telling you all this for a reason. Billy's sister-in-law is Pam Adams. And it is with Pam and Billy's brother Joe that she has lived for the last 7 years. When she moved from Morro Bay to Shafter, she had her own room and bathroom built on the house where they were living, and she's been there for years. And they were literally like sisters. They grew up in the same town. They went to the same high school. Now they were living under the same roof, and they were literally like sisters. And through this whole past week, Pam has been there by her bedside. When that grandma shouldn't have pinched her so badly. I'm telling you. I only said that because my mother used to pinch me in church, all right? So, do mothers pinch anymore in church? I don't know if mothers do that anymore, but it was quite effective in my day. Friday afternoon, Shelly and I were able to get away again. I'd been down five times this week and got to spend a lot of time. And Friday afternoon, Shelley was able to go with me, and we spent about 7-8 hours there. And I mean, Pam has really been at her bedside through the vast majority of this time. As we left Friday night around 9 o'clock, I didn't really expect, I figured I had said my goodbye to Billy Friday night. And on our way home, Shelley and I prayed for, you know, God's timing and God's best, and knew that this was imminent. And so I woke up early Saturday morning and got my update and found out 3:30, they thought that was it, and all of a sudden she rallied. And so I said, well, I'm on my way. So I jumped in the car. I'm heading down. As I'm heading down, I get a call from Pam, her sister-in-law. And Pam said, Tim, I just need you to pray. She said, I will not be there when you get there. She said, I got a call just a few minutes ago. My 90-year-old father fell in the kitchen. They've called for an EMT group, an ambulance to come, and they're confident that his hip is broken. A little humor in the midst of this distress. He slipped and fell in the kitchen on his way to do some laundry, because he did it now for he and his wife, because she's almost 90 and her health is not good. And he thought of this as he was coming out of the shower. And so, rather than forget, he went straight to the laundry room, fell in the kitchen. He's laying in the kitchen buck naked, all right, at 90. So I'm thinking when I hear this story, oh, I wonder where his wife is. Did she have to get dressed? I'm thinking there's hope, okay? But anyway, the prognosis of that, and so Pam is no longer at Billy's bedside, who we know death is imminent. She's now on her way to a hospital, to an ER unit, with her dad, who's 90, and what we believe is a fractured hip. The reports over the next few hours is it's not his hip, it is his femur, where it goes into the hip socket. Surgery is required. Without surgery, he would never get out of bed again. Without surgery, he was already in excruciating pain, and it would be a long period of time of excruciating pain. Surgery is required, but the risk is 50-50. At his age, the risk of this surgery is 50-50. Now, the good news in this side is he's never had health issues. This has been a very healthy man for a long time. He only stopped golfing about 2.5 years ago. And I golfed with him in his early 80s once, and I've never seen a guy drive a golf ball so far. This was an oil man, all right? He worked for a large oil corporation out of Saudi Arabia, all right, in the 70s and the 80s before he retired. So here's Pam, a sister-in-law that she's been with every day, now can't be here for those closing moments of her life. Now not sure what's going to be the end result of her dad. His name is Ardell. I asked the 8 o'clock service to be praying because he went into service at 8 a.m. this morning. I got an update while I was sitting there. He is out of surgery and he is doing well. The doctors are very pleased, so for that we're grateful. But here was the rest of our story, the rest of our concern. Aunt Toot, we know she loved the Lord. She had walked with Christ for decades now. Though there were moments that we shed tears in her room, there were also hours of laughter in her room, because we were imagining what she was going to see first. We were imagining whether it was Ted or John, her brother-in-law or brother who's already there, was going to pull which prank on her. We played some incredible music that she loved to hear, and talked about soon and very soon, and when we all get to heaven. And so there was this great, in the midst of our loss, there was this great sense of joy as well. Pam did not go to the ER at the hospital for her dad with that same sense of joy. When she got the message that it's a 50-50 chance he would live, her concern became this: I have no idea if my dad is a Christian. This was a man who made millions in his life. This is a man who physically could do anything that he wanted to do. This was a man who thumbed his nose at God for decades. He made fun of his daughter and made fun of his grandkids who were Christians. Though we often believe that part of that was a cover-up for some of his own questions, we thought some of it was his way of challenging them to see if they really believed, but he never would share. And so there was this great dread about Ardell. Do you see the difference? You're in the midst, but one of them, there is a great sense of joy. With the other, there is no joy. So Pam could not be with us all day on Saturday. She actually was able to get away. When they got him changed to a room and she needed to go pick up her mother to take her mother back, and she came by just 2 minutes after Toot left this world. She was able to be there with all of us for the next 10 or 15 or 20 minutes and then filled us in on Ardell and said, just please pray. She said, I don't know how to talk to my dad about Jesus, but I'm scared for him. As we wrapped up things in Toot's room, two of the other people who were in the room with us with Billy were Ardell's two granddaughters. They're both adults, grown. But we got to be honest, everybody knows he had a favorite. This granddad had a favorite. And that favorite was his first and for many years his only grandchild, Robbie. He has spoiled her to no end. At times, to a point, it was not good for her. But Robbie loves the Lord. And so as we're about to finish things up, and I'm sitting there, and I'm trying to decide, should I drive into Bakersfield, and should I talk to Ardell myself? And I prayed, Lord, give me wisdom. Give me wisdom. And Robbie's sitting right there, and she just had said a beautiful prayer, and all of a sudden it said, she's the best one to go talk. And I looked across this small gap between Robbie and I said, Robbie, I'm going to ask a favor of you. I want to challenge you. She said, okay, what? I said, you were your grandpa's favorite. And I said, I want to challenge you, when you leave here, go to the hospital. And I want to challenge you, walk into that room and look at your grandfather and say, Grandpa, I'm going to do the talking this time. There's some things I need to share with you. These are very important to me, and I need you to listen. And I said, tell your grandfather what you've just left and what you just experienced. And tell him you don't have that same confidence and you cannot have that same experience if tomorrow, which is now today, were to go bad. And that you need to know for sure, your family wants to know, does he know Jesus personally? And so, she got teary-eyed. And then I got to find where my phone is. And then she said, I'll do it. So we left. I get about an hour down the road coming home. Hold on. Here we go. She said, Tim, it's Robbie. Say a prayer. I'm heading into the hospital to be a fisher of men. I said, I've been praying. Hour later, she sent this text. Tim, it went well. He told me Jesus is my Savior. He said yes so quickly, I was nervous. I wanted to make sure he really knew what he was talking about. Very intelligent man. In fact, I had just given Pam, his daughter, a book to give to him. It's the book that came out with God's Not Dead 2. Okay? Man, Myth, or Messiah. She said, I talked to him about, do you know what you mean? I told him how important this was to me, that I knew where he was going after this life, before he faced this surgery. We talked about the peace that our family had, knowing where Toot is. We also, we both have agreed now, we're going to read the book you sent together, so that when he gets out of the hospital, we can talk about it together. Thanks for giving me the challenge. I have always worried about his faith, but I'm not worried anymore. Amen. Everybody can be a fisher of men. Amen. And those who are our family members, those who are the closest to us, you don't have to ask for some hitman like a preacher to go talk to them. You can do that yourself. I tell you that story because it really is important for where we're going. And my wife told me I had to finish on time today. Yeah, it may not happen. Anyway, a little boy walked into a grocery store and he asked the clerk for a box of Dove detergent. The clerk said, "What do you need the detergent for, son?" The little boy said, "I want to wash my dog." The gentleman said, "Well, son, Dove detergent's pretty strong for washing a small dog." The little boy said, "But that's what I want." "Okay, if you're sure, but be very careful when you use it on your dog. It's too strong. It might hurt him." About a week later, the little boy came back in the store, and the clerk recognized him and said, "Son, how's your dog doing?" The boy said, "He's dead." The clerk said, "Oh, son, I'm sorry. I told you that Dove detergent was awfully strong. It might kill him." The little boy shook his head and said, no, sir, I don't think it was the Dove detergent that killed him. I think it was the rinse cycle that got him." It may be that you feel or have felt at some time in your life that you have been through the rinse cycle. You're burdened. Your heart is heavy. You feel that nothing has been going right for you. Nothing but negative things seem to be coming your way. Honestly, I think all of us have been through rent cycles already, and we've probably got a few more in our future. I have never met a person in my life who hasn't had some kind of rent cycle moment in their life. Since it's Rodeo Roundup Sunday, I had to find a cowboy story. There's an old story of a cowboy who walked into a saloon. You notice cowboys always walk into saloons, they never walk into church. Just thought I'd point that out. This cowboy walked in a saloon only to discover that somebody, did I say walk in or walk out? Okay, he walked out. After he'd already walked in, but now he's walking out, only to discover that somebody had painted his horse's tail red. As people looked with laughter, he was furious inside, and he said, "Does anybody know who did this? I saw who done it," somebody shouted. He was wearing a vest but no hat, and he went straight from here to the hardware store over there." "I'll tear him limb from limb," that cowboy said. He stormed off in the direction of the store. He flung open the door and he said, "Did somebody in here paint my horse's tail red? If so, let him be a man and step forward." This huge, giant blacksmith stepped out from behind a stack of barbed wire. His arms were like fence posts. He appeared to be chiseled from rock. Everybody in the store kept silent as this guy snarled back, "I did it. And what do you have to say about it?" Cowboy looked at this massive blacksmith, sized up his options, and said, "Sure looks like to me that first coat is dry. Do you want to apply the second coat or should I?" Now, the point of the story is this. The enemy of this world, and rarely do we ever like to call his name because we think it makes us sound foolish, but his name is Satan, the devil, Beelzebub. He's a lot bigger and stronger than most of us give him credit for. And make no mistake, he has an intense purpose to accomplish. The Bible says he seeks to deceive and to destroy. In other words, he wants to paint our tails red, match his. We have to go through rent cycles in life. And sometimes they leave us with a red tail. And what all of us want to know at these rent cycle moments of life is, can life get better? And if so, how? And I don't think there's anything wrong with wanting a better life, at least in the context of what this series is all about. This series is about less of stuff and more of Christ. Less stress, more peace. Less frustration, greater joy. Less anger, more peace. That's a better life, I think. And Psalm 37 is a psalm that alerts us to the dangers of a wicked life and the blessings of a righteous life. And it challenges us not to allow momentary benefits to confuse us with the eternal blessings that God has for us. Satan often sneaks up on us by letting we look at somebody else who's got something good going for them and we want that. And we think to ourselves, well, they got that dishonestly. Why shouldn't I have some of that? And here's the challenge as we begin to jump into Psalm 37. All of us want to believe that we are the righteous that David's talking about. None of us want to say that we are the wicked. Let me simplify this if I can. This is not a this is not a definition by degrees. In other words, I can get more and more and more righteous, or that I can be less and less wicked. This is not how this is determined. The righteousness and the wickedness of our life is determined by our choice on the fault line of history. It's determined by our decision about Jesus Christ. That's what moves us. If you are not in a relationship with Jesus Christ, guess which side of the fault line you fall on? It's the wicked side. And here's the deal. Everybody who was on the righteous side were once on the wicked side. That's his plan. But Tim, I'm not wicked. Don't look at somebody else to see if you were wicked or not. Compare yourself to the one who hung on the cross. That puts all of us, that's why Romans says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It puts us all in the same place. Psalm 37 resembles a chapter out of the book of Proverbs more than it does the other hymns of the book of Psalms. This is a psalm that does not contain a prayer, and there's no reference to David's own personal circumstances or his problems like many of the other psalms do. This psalm does not contain a prayer, and there's no reference, as I said, to David, except that he wrote it. This is the utterance of a sound, practical wisdom and godliness that fall from the lips of somebody who has experience and age. It's like an elder in the church gathering a group of us around and saying, let me tell you what I've learned from the Word. Or it's like a father affectionately admonishing and advising his grown children and grandchildren. Maybe, just maybe, it is the result of Psalm 37, David sharing this with Solomon, that prompted Solomon to write the book of Proverbs. Because when we read this, if you read Psalm 37 and then you go read the 31 chapters of the book of Proverbs, you're going to say, wow, this should have been Proverbs 32. By the way, if you've never read through the book of Proverbs, could I make a suggestion to you? It works perfect for 8 months of the year. How many days are there? Let's see. 31, yeah. September, February. How does that little saying go? 30 days has September, April, June, and November. All the rest have 31, save for February, which only the rhyme kind of gets screwed up there. So 7 of the 8 months, all right, have 31. So all this would mean is in 5 other months out of the year, 4 of those 5 months, you'd have to read 2 chapters the last day of the month. And in February, depending on leap year or not, you might have to read 3 or 4 chapters the last day. But Proverbs works out well. Read a chapter every day and then do that for an entire year. You would go through the book of Proverbs 12 times. I think you'd be incredibly, incredibly astounded at how your life would change just by spending that much time contemplating the book of Proverbs. Psalm 37 gives us a challenging contrast. Wicked people often flourish in this life, and righteous people frequently are in distress in this life. But what takes place afterwards is a very different story. 1 Corinthians ratifies what David wrote. For in 1 Corinthians 6:9, Paul said these words, "Do you not know?" It's kind of like a double negative. You really don't know this? Of course you do. What is it that we should know, Paul? That the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God. And if you keep reading, he actually pinpoints how wickedness looks in the life of people. Well, let's jump in. We're only going to have time to do half of what I intended today. I figured that out in the last service. All right? People are starting to fan, so let's turn on the cooler on this side, because I already did the one on this side. The inside one. The inside one. Turn it to cool and to about 72 degrees. Thank you very much. All right, what we're going to notice in the first 9 verses of Psalm 37 is that there is a warning. This kind of begins with a warning, and verse 9 ends with a warning. And it's the same warning. So that means it's pretty important. Pay attention, all right? I'm going to begin, and I'm going to end with the warning. And in between, David gives us at least 5 precepts that keep us away from those warnings. We don't have to, if we will do these things in our life, you don't have to worry about this warning. Or, hey, if this warning is a concern to you, follow these precepts, and then the consequences of those warnings will not be your judgment. So let's jump in. Let me just read those 9 verses quickly. He says, "Do not fret because of evil men." Back in the 80s, the way the Canadians would have said this is, "Don't worry, be happy." Okay? Do not fret because of evil men. In other words, one translator said it this way: don't have heartburn because of evil men. Or be envious of those who do wrong. And let me pause right here for just a moment. The phraseology is most important here, and don't just run by this. Don't be envious of those who do wrong. In other words, David says, there are people who do wrong, who for a period of time, they appear to be blessed, and you're envious. There are people who do wrong that, wow, you wished you had what they had because of what they got by doing wrong. And he says, don't be envious of those things. And he'll let us know why in just a moment. Okay, verse 2. "For like the grass, they will soon wither." The benefits that they are enjoying right now, they'll be gone before long. And that's all there is what they had at the moment. "Like green plants, they will soon die." Trust in the Lord. This is the cure for fretting. If you fret, if you worry, you need to learn to trust in the Lord. Okay, the object of your trust is the shepherd, it's Christ. Trust in Him and do good. This is the song, "Trust and Obey." I think it was a month or so ago, came across a line and I shared it with you. If we don't obey, then we don't trust. We like to be people who say, well, I trust, but not obey. No, obedience is the evidence that we trust. "Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture." Do you know what that? This is a throwback to Psalm 23. Yea, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down where? In green pastures, and He leads me by still waters. What this really means is we'll be well fed. Our souls are going to be nourished by God. Then verse 4, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart." Then verse 5, "Commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do this." What will He do? "He will make your righteousness," which is His righteousness, "shine like the dawn, the justice of your cause like the noonday sun." Be still. That word "be still" is a Hebrew word that is translated in a few other places, rest. Be still, rest before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. There were moments it was wearisome waiting for Aunt Toot to go to heaven. It's not that we wanted to see her go, but it was we were troubled by seeing her stay. And waiting, and the girls would look at me and say, "Tim, why is God taking so long?" I said, "I don't have the answer to that question, but I know He has an appointed time, and we can trust Him for it." We may not learn till after it's over, but there are reasons beyond what we can figure out. That's where I've learned to trust. So we just be still and we'll wait. Do not fret when men succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It only leads to evil. Let me pause there because I might not get back to this later. Do you understand what David said? Where do actions and decisions that we make when we're frustrated and angry, what do they end up being? Evil. Figure that out now. That's why he says wait and rest. If you wait and rest, that's the antidote to anger and frustration. What's the first thing you were taught as a kid to do when you get mad? Yeah, that was, I don't know if the guy who came up with that was had the Bible in mind when he did it, but he know if I slow down, if I wait, I won't do something I will regret later on. And David here is pretty definitive here. When you rush ahead and you respond with anger or wrath, it only, there's no exceptions, it only leads to evil. For evil men will be cut off, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. Let's quickly look at the five precepts that are here. Number one, trust and obey. Active obedience is the result of trusting. Dwight L. Moody, the founder of Moody Bible Institute, one time said, "Trust in yourself and you're doomed to disappointment. Trust in money and it may be taken from you. Trust in your reputation and some slanderous tongue may blast it away, but trust in God and you will never be confounded in time today or eternity tomorrow." The psalmist is saying, don't put your trust in people, wealthy people, or people who have seemed to have it made in life. He says, put your trust in the Lord, because every one of those people will die, but the Lord does not. People come and go, but the Lord is here to stay. He's eternal from everlasting to everlasting. He has no beginning and no end. Put our trust in Him. We often put entirely too much emphasis on making money, in having popularity, in acquiring material things. If we want to be like somebody, be like, amen, I'm afraid somebody would say Mike. Be like Jesus. How many of you watched the Golden State Warriors yesterday? I didn't get to. I missed it. All right. I was watching somebody launch to heaven. But I did have it on my cell phone and popping up the updated scores every now and then. All right. And Aunt Toot loved basketball, so I kept Aunt Toot apprised of how they were doing. You know, when Michael Jordan was the star, that's where the phrase be like Mike came from. Right now, people want to be like Steph. Okay. Man, I see parents. I can just see parents out there now. They're teaching their sons and their daughters how to dribble with two hands. All right, and I got to tell you, I love Steph. I was not a Golden State Warrior fan. I'm a Lakers fan. Just man, I'm in a drought. And I got to be honest. I even watched the game the other night when Golden State set all those records instead of watching the closing. I watched it later. All right. The thing I do like about Steph. Is he loves Jesus, and he's vocal about it. When he was being interviewed after shooting 402 threes in a season, after his team winning the most games ever in a season, after scoring more than 40 points so that his average for the year would exceed 30 points a game, he was being interviewed by a commentator and all kinds of questions, and his wife comes by him. Steph's wife comes by, plants a kiss on his shoulder, and then tries to hurry and get out of the TV camera. And this commentator thought, I'm going to steal a quote from Steph's wife. And she turns away from Steph and says, hey, tell me why your husband's so great. She turned around, didn't stop walking. She turned around, just one word, God! She yelled it. And the commentator was kind of, well, no, really, why? One word, God! And she walked off. This commentator really had no idea what to do at that moment, hardly. She kind of stammered, went back to Steph. You see, yeah, Steph said, guys, we sometimes invest so much. I'm a dad guilty of this, so much time helping our kids succeed in their baseball, in their basketball, in their debates, and acquiring this. Do we spend as much time and energy telling them how important God is? How important Jesus is? that it's to be like not whoever is promoting the greatest looking tennis shoe out there right now, but the one who gives us a garment of clothes that will never wear out, who gives us a home that will never, ever end. Delight and enjoy. Number two, found in verse 4. Delight and enjoy the desires that God will give you. Listen, you will never learn, we will never learn to delight ourselves in the Lord until we get into His presence by being in His Word. And as a result of being in His Word, we then talk to Him about what we're learning and discovering about ourselves and about Him. And your life will never get better until you do that. The psalmist said, delight in the Lord and He'll give you the desires of your heart. Some people think that this scripture is a blanket promise from God to get whatever we want. Just get close to God and He'll give you whatever you want. That is not what this verse is saying. When we learn to delight ourselves in the Lord, when we get delighted and excited with Him, then His wants are going to become our wants. When I was a boy in elementary school and I lived next door to Dwight, Dwight was about 4 or 5 years older than I was, and Dwight collected comic books. I wished I still had all the comic books that I had collected along with Dwight when I was in the fifth grade. I had some first edition Superman, Batman books. I had a love for collecting comic books at that time in my life. You know why? Because I spent time with Dwight. Okay. When I got to be 12, I started spending time with a guy 10 years older than me. His name was George Rogers, and George Rogers loved to bird hunt. Guess who took me? Senior moment. What do you call the sporting goods? Herb Bowers. He is the one who took me to Herb Bowers and took me through the hunter safety course and took me down to get my first hunting license. Why do you think I fell in love with bird hunting? Because I spent a lot of time with George. Those that we spend time with and those that we admire and love, they will begin to influence the desires of our heart. Now, as much as I have enjoyed bird hunting and as much as I have enjoyed comic books at a season of my life, I'm also grateful that I spent a lot of time with a mom and a dad who loved me enough to tell me that Jesus loved me. And so the love that my parents had for Jesus and the love that I saw them model in their life and the love that I saw got them through crisis after crisis in their world also became a Jesus that I wanted. And when I spend time with Jesus and the desires of His heart become the desires of my heart, and it's the reason I tell folks you need to be in the book. There's nothing wicked about a lot of desires that we can have, but they may not be God's best for our life. I had somebody years ago, I wished I could remember who it was, but they proposed to me a question that stuck with me. And they said, Tim, if God doesn't want you to have it, do you still want it? I hated the question then, and I'm not sure I like it a whole lot better today, but I appreciate it. It slows me down to think, God, is this your best? Is this what you want? The scripture does not give us a blank check for anything and everything just because we go to church, but if we truly delight in the Lord and His Word, we get excited about our relationship with Him, He will bless us with greater peace, greater joy, less stress, less worry, less fear. And I want that, don't you? Number three, verse 5. Commit and shine. Commit to the Lord whatever you do and your plans will succeed. That's Proverbs 6:3, Philippians 4:6. Do not be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving present your requests to God. I believe the Lord is saying in this verse of Scripture and others that if we will pray about everything, not just the big stuff, but everything that concerns us, He'll bring us blessings. He'll give us answers and leadership. And sometimes He'll even give us success. Christian Burke, in a book called Major League Dad, wrote, traded from the Montreal Expos to a Double A team in Nashville, pitcher Tim Burke, and Danny Boitano was in the 8 o'clock service. He knew of Tim Burke. It was his worst start inning. He allowed Chattanooga to score 4 runs. His wife recalls that evening, Tim said, after tonight, there's a strong chance I'll be released. I could be out of baseball for good. She said, "Tim, maybe we need to turn your career over to the Lord." And Tim responded without hesitation, "You think he cares? But I think that's a good idea." On our knees by our kitchen table, they prayed. And Tim said, "Lord, I never even thought about you caring about this stuff. If I'm holding on to baseball too much, help me let it go. If you want me to keep going, let me know, and I'll fight to be all you want me to be." Then his wife said, "Lord, if you'll give Tim strength and opportunity, he'll give you his all. But if this is not your will for us to be in baseball, show us what you have next for us." When we finished that night, we still had no idea what was going to lay ahead of us, but we did have a new sense of peace in this moment of uncertainty. And do you want to know the rest of the story? Tim did not lose another baseball game that season, and he had several more seasons in the bigs. But they don't always turn out that way. Sometimes God says, "No, I don't want any more baseball or owning a business or being wealthy. That's not my next step for you." And so what do we do then? We rest and we wait. Verse 7, rest and wait. "Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him." Wait for God's actions. Remember this, time is not a factor to God. Oh, it is to us, like how I'm supposed to be finished right now. But does God ever hurry? Does God run? I remember Major Thomas standing right here one Sunday morning asking us another question. Does God sweat? I don't think God sweats or runs about anything. Last of all, refrain and turn. This is the resting and the waiting. Refrain and turn is the result of resting and waiting. The warning reminder in verse 8, do not fret. It only leads to evil. And the ultimate but blessing in Scripture is found in verse 9. Those who hope in the Lord, they will inherit the land. Aunt Toot inherited the land at 3:40 yesterday. We have confidence now that Ardell, if things had gone badly today, would have inherited the land. Let me close with this. And we will finish Psalm 37 next week because there's so much more. While walking down the street one day, a United States senator was tragically hit by a truck and he dies. His soul arrives in heaven and he's met by St. Peter at the entrance. "Welcome home," says St. Peter. "But before you settle in, it seems we have a problem. We seldom see a highly elected official like you around these parts. We're not sure what to do with you." "No problem," he said, "just let me in." Peter said, "Well, I'd like to, but I've got orders from a little higher up. What we'll have to do is let you spend one day in hell and then one day in heaven. And then you can choose where you would like to spend eternity." "Really?" he said, "I've already made up my mind. I want to be in heaven." "I'm sorry, but we have to follow the orders." And with that, St. Peter escorts him to the elevator and down he goes. The door opens up, and to his surprise, in the distance, there's a clubhouse. He sees a golf course, and standing in front of the clubhouse are all of his friends and other politicians he had worked with. Everybody's happy. They're dressed in evening gowns and tuxedos. They run to greet him. They shake his hand. They reminisce about the good times they had fleecing other people. They play a friendly game of golf. Do I have any elected senators in here? Okay. They play a friendly game of golf, and then that evening they dine on lobster, caviar, and champagne. Also present is the devil, who really is a very friendly guy. He has a good time dancing, telling jokes. They're having the time of their life before he realizes 24 hours have passed. And St. Peter shows up, and he takes him to the elevator, and all of his friends down there give him a hearty farewell, and the elevator goes up, up, up. And the doors open, and they're in heaven. Now it's time to visit heaven. So 24 hours pass with the senator enjoying a group of very contented people. They're at rest. They're at peace. He's never experienced this kind of tranquility in his life, and he's having a really good time. And then he realizes that 24 hours are up, and St. Peter pops up and says, "Well, you've spent a day in hell, and you spent a day in heaven. Where would you like to spend eternity?" The senator reflects on it a moment, and then he answers, "Well, I would have never said this before, but heaven's been delightful and restful. I've never experienced anything like it. But I think I have a lot more in common, and I would be better off in hell." So St. Peter escorts him to the elevator, and he goes down. Now the doors of the elevator open, and he's in the middle of a barren wasteland. It's covered with garbage and refuse. And he sees all of his friends. They're now dressed in rags, picking up trash and putting it in black bags as more trash falls from above. And the devil comes over to him and he puts his arm around his shoulder. And the senator stammers, Satan, I don't understand. Yesterday I was here and there was a golf course and a clubhouse and we had lobster and caviar and we danced and we had a great time. Now it's just a wasteland of garbage and my friends look miserable. What happened? And the devil looks at him and smiles and said, yesterday we were campaigning for your vote. Today we have it. And you see, I know most of us get caught up in that story with the political side of it. But don't miss the spiritual thrust of that story. The evil one in this world is seeking to deceive us, to get us to believe that either heaven or hell doesn't exist, and heaven doesn't exist, or hell will not be as bad as you think it is until you get there. Your vote's been cast, and your vote is cast based upon what you do with this fault line. It's the fault line of sin that separates us from God. And the cross of Jesus Christ is the bridge that enables us to move from sinner to saint, from wicked to righteous, from evil to good. It is not our good behavior. It is not our good intentions. It is our decision. What will I do with the finished work of Jesus Christ? It is what Robbie, a granddaughter, wanted to hear from Ardell, a grandfather, that yes, Jesus is my Savior, and I've chosen Him. Do you have those precepts functioning in your life? Maybe if you don't, it's because you've never made the choice at the fault line. Why not make that choice today? Maybe you've got somebody God has put on your mind, a member of your family, and you need to go today and say exactly what Robbie said to her grandpa last night. In love, in kindness. In fact, it's the kindest loving thing you could do. Go and be a fisher of people. Let's pray. Father, if I take this long in the last service, I might be joining you sooner than I thought. But Lord, I trust you with the needs of each of us who are in this room at this moment. Maybe some have been startled by what has been said here today. Maybe some for the very first time have had to come face to face with the fact that because they've not chosen Christ, they find themselves on the evil, wicked side of the fault line. May they not stay there. May their pride not get in the way. May humility reign. May they say, I want to be on the other side of the fault line. Thank you, Jesus, for putting a bridge to bring me from one to the other. Thank you. For those of us who may be motivated, spurred by your Spirit to direct us to somebody else that we haven't spoken to about faith in you, may we find a boldness that is not our own. We trust you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Guys, have a great day.